everyone, my name is Beatrice. I am graduate in art history and today I will guide your visit of Tommaso Spinola Palace and let you admire the extraordinary frescoes and through them discover a little more of the mid-16th century Genoa. We are now in Salita Santa Caterina, to get right in front of the palace, built in the late 50s of the 16th century by Tommaso Spinola, who entrusted for the blueprint of the palace the architect Giovan Battista Castello, commonly known as the Bergamasco. The architect had to deal with not only the mere architectural aspect, but also with the decoration design of the facade on Santa Caterina hillside, such as the monumental portal. By passing through the portal, we reach the atrium, where it's possible to appreciate the genial solution adopted by the Bergamasco to overcome two evident problems in the structure: the difference in height between the entrance and the walkway towards the stairwell, and the asymmetry given by the excessive shift to the left of the stairs. He solved both by designing a monumental staircase and a triforium diaphragm giving monumentality to the room. This space is enclosed by the ground floor, as well as those leading to the first floor have a fresco decoration dating back to the 60s of the 16th century, which was realized by the brothers Andrea and Ottavio Semino. The decoration is characterized by a large square placed in the center of the vault, illustrating mythological episodes. On the first floor, entering the large hall and looking at the ceiling, we admire the extraordinary frescoes by brothers Andrea and Ottavio Semino in the 60s of the 16th century, depicting some glorious feats of the Emperor Charles V. On the far right of the large central panel, we may glimpse his royal silhouette, characterized by some attributes expressing his incredible power. The golden fleece around his neck, the Habsburg eagle standing out on the pavilion behind him, his head surrounded by laurels. With some powerful gesture, he turns to a figure kneeling in front of him in the act of asking me for his grace. It is John Frederick of Saxony, a former commander of the Schmalkaldic League, in which all the Protestant electors of the German area who refused to participate in the Council of Trent have gathered. The right section of the central panel illustrates the epilogue of this famous clash, and we see many Habsburg soldiers around and defeated the soldiers of the League. The outcome of the battle was fundamental for the imperial policy of Charles V, who thus obtained control of vast areas of influence, which he united under the banner of the same religion. Genoa was included in his empire, and in the same year the city experienced the tragic history of the Fieschi conspiracy against a member of the Doria family. Because of Andrea Doria's choice of favoring the Spanish alliance, thus inaugurating a period of prosperity and stability, the Fieschi family turned against him, and at the end they were defeated. Considering this, the event in the frescoes assume a twofold significance. On one hand, an open and strong support for imperial power. On the other hand, an observation of the futility of any kind of rebellion against this excess of power, with an evident parallelism between German rebels and Genoese conspirators. This interpretation is confirmed by the side panels, representing the five fundamental stages in the consolidation of Charles V's power, starting with the famous Battle of Pavia in 1525, when the Emperor defeated the French King Francis I. Moving to the second panel, we see the Siege of Florence in 1529-30, which involved Charles himself, which led to a period of dissent with the state of the Church after the sack of Rome of 1527. Then the depiction of the liberation of the city of Vienna from the siege by Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent by the Habsburg troops in the same year as the siege of Florence. This series of the four panels ends with the one depicting Charles V talking with his admiral Andrea Doria at the afterwards of the important conquest of Tunis in 1535, to which Doria had contributed considerably by making available a large fleet of galleys and thus reconfirming his role as guarantor in the alliance between Genoa and Spain. The decoration is then crowned by the fresco depicting four allegorical female embodying the victory, the naval victory, the peace, and the fame. We are about to discover a smaller room next to the large hall in which, looking up at the ceiling, we cannot help but being fascinated by the preciousness of the frescoes painted here by one of the most famous artists of the Genoese 16th century, Luca Cambiaso. This extraordinary artist, in his full professional maturity in the mid-60s of the 16th century, created a composition of the highest quality but enigmatic in reading. Focusing on the central frame, it is easily noticed that the protagonists of the scene are divided into three groups and are arranged according to a pyramidal structure. At the top, Apollo, who is sitting on a Mount Parnassus, dialogues with an armed figure, giving his back to the spectator, while at the corners of the base, two groups of muses that stand out for the beauty of the draperies moved by a wind on inside the fresco and their refined hairstyles and poses. The figure talking with Apollo, though, could be linked to the positive figure of Cypselus, the tyrant of Corinth, who, according to what Herodotus wrote in his stories, was able to put an end to a long dynastic hegemony in favor of a good governance. Therefore, this figure in relation to Genoa could be consistent with the change of alliance in favor of Spain made by Andrea Doria in 1528. Let us focus on a curious detail of these frescoes, the one depicting the beginning of this history according to the proposed iconography. Is set in a wonderful bathroom of that time, which is interesting because it providing the spectator a glimpse of a setting evoking the marvelous private baths that had been created by Galeazzo Alessi and which were so successful that they were cited as a champion of the quality by Vasari himself in his main work, Lives. By concluding our visit, some more information about the historical path of the palace. It passed on to various other owners over the centuries, and today it is inscribed in the list of 42 recognized World Heritage Sites by the UNESCO. It is open now and shown for the first time to the general public, allowing to appreciate those characteristics of modernity and richness that already in 1588 made it worthy of being a public house and to welcome illustrious guests.